good morning. Welcome to week two of our new series, Modern Family. Catchy opening, eh? Yeah. You know, my name's Pastor Jim, by the way, and we're delighted to have you with us. Whether you're able to be here, or maybe you're in the platinum seating video overflow, or maybe you're watching via the internet. Either way, really glad you're here. And I want you to know that regardless the particular family situation you find yourself in, there's going to be something for you in this series. Modern families are very different. That's kind of why we wanted to do that opening, to show you some of the families in our church, and there's just such a wide variety of families. So it may be that you're here and, you know, you're single in Dubai. You're a family of one. Or it may be that you're here and you're living apart from your family because of work. They're back in your home country. And I understand. We're going to have something for you as well in the series. It may be that you're, maybe you're just married, newly married. How many of you, by the way, let's just take a little second. How many of you, let's say, were married within the last year? Can you raise your hand? Have some of those people? Yeah, back there? Anyone else? Usually they don't have to raise their hands because you can just tell from the big smile. It's like, yes, you fortunate people, you. You know, kind of. If you only knew what was coming. No, it's not true. Or, you know, it may be that you've been married a long time and you have a lot of kids, too many kids. Can you have too many kids? I don't think you can. Anyway, whatever you say, maybe you're a single dad or you're a single mom. Maybe you're in one of those big, new, blended families, you know, the kind I'm talking about, where you kind of have to have a program when the holidays come to keep up with everybody. You know, it's like, now, who are you again? And you were married to my wife when? I don't remember, hello, son, how are you my son, her son, our son? Oh, you're the caterer. Oh, okay, well, never mind. those are fun times. Or maybe you come from a very small, close-knit, intimate family. That's the way I grew up. My family was just my older brother and I who really loved each other. And then my saintly mom and my dad who worked all the time. So maybe your family was something like that. So regardless of whatever your family situation is, I want you to know that over the next few weeks, we're going to be seeking godly wisdom that we believe will help you in your family. So I hope you'll try and be here every week. You know, we started last week by looking at the greatest psalm on family in all the Bible. You know where it is? Psalm 127. Psalms 127. So in case you weren't here, you might want to go home and read that psalm. I tell you, some great stuff in there. Or you might even want to get online and, we have a new YouTube channel. Fancy us. Yeah. And you can actually watch the whole sermon, you know. So you might want to, it's at fellowshipdubai.com. So you just go to our website and follow the clicks, and you'll be right there. So today what I want to do is to answer a question. And that question is, what is the single most important word for every family and for every home? One word, if you had to sum it all up and say, one word is more important than anything else, what would it be? Think about it for a minute. Go ahead. Think about it. Maybe the word love comes to mind. I mean, after all, it is Valentine's Day today. Yeah. And several of you married guys just went, yay! Gosh, oh no! Yeah. And again? Yeah, every year at this time, my friend, every year. Just write it on your calendar. It's not that hard. Or maybe the word grace would come to your mind. Families need grace. Maybe the word happiness. Happy home. Maybe the word laughter. Maybe the word patience. Anybody here not need patience? But I'll tell you, after 35 years of being a pastor and seeing families in all types of situations and problems and traumas, I mean, every type of family, every size, every variety, you know, every ethnicity, every economic level, I tell you, in my mind, there's one word that's more important than anything else. And you know what it is? It's the word forgiveness. I think that is essential. Without forgiveness, you won't have a family to enjoy all those other words. In my years as a pastor, I've been involved in a lot of family counseling, a lot of family interventions, a lot of family arbitrations. And it's almost gotten to the point where I can tell you in the very beginning, after 30 minutes, which families are going to survive and which families are going to disintegrate. And it all has to do with forgiveness. Now, the kind of forgiveness that I want us to talk about today is, it's not the kind that you need in your family when your mom shrinks your favorite sweater in the dryer, or your son backs over the cat in the driveway, or your husband forgets Valentine's. Guys, am I looking out for you? All right. Brothers got to stick together. No, the kind of forgiveness I'm talking about is much, much deeper and much more difficult than that. The kind of forgiveness I want us to talk about today is the kind that you need when a husband or wife comes home and admits that they've been having an affair with a coworker. It's the kind of forgiveness you need when your son gets caught selling drugs at school. It's the kind of forgiveness you need when your 16-year-old daughter comes home and says, "Yeah, I'm pregnant and I need an abortion, so deal with it." It's the kind of forgiveness you need when you discover to your horror that there's been a molestation or a rape in your family. I mean, not our family. That happens to other people, not us. No? No, it happens to all kinds of people. It's the kind of forgiveness you need when your son suddenly tells you that he wants to go live with his father, and your heart just kind of melts within you. It's the kind of forgiveness you need when you finally tell your mom and dad that you're gay, and your dad looks at you and he says, "I hate you and I never want to see you again, and you are no longer my son or you are no longer my daughter." Now, I'm not trying to defend any of these crisis situations or make an opinion about it. I'm just trying to say this is real life in the modern family. And I want you to listen now. I want you to know every single one of these incidences has happened in this church since I've been pastor. I dare say if today we had the time and the courage, we could go seat by seat, row by row through this entire room, and we would discover that every single family represented here needs this kind of forgiveness in some level, in some way. Maybe it's not you personally. Maybe it's what happened to your sister. Maybe it's, what happened between your mom and dad. Maybe it's, something that between your children. I don't know. But what we're talking about today is right at the heart of the modern family. Modern families have modern problems. But that doesn't mean that they hurt any less or any more heartbreaking than the family's problems that have existed since the Garden of Eden. Today we want to find out, what does God have to say about the kind of forgiveness that can get you through these kinds of problems? Now, this is such a touching and an involved subject, I think maybe we should start with prayer. Would you pray with me, please? Let's pray. Bow your heads. Heavenly Father, we are in need of you today, desperately in need of you. Life is hard in Dubai at times. Life's hard everywhere at times. But it seems like international living, with all the travel, the work, the excessive work, with all the pressures and stress of having third culture kids, with all the temptations that exist, Lord, internationally. Father, it just seems that there are so many heartbreaking situations in the lives of so many families and singles within our church. And Lord, we just call on you today. We ask you that you would meet our needs, that you would bring us comfort, that you would give us instruction and counsel. Lord, we don't know what to do. I don't know what to say. No human does. But Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you that you have breathed it through people to us today so that we can have insights and understanding, and that, Lord, we can we can learn of Jesus and we can learn how to be like Jesus. And we pray, Lord, that you would help us now. Be our teacher, Lord, none other can. And help us to learn forgiveness. It's in Jesus' name we all pray and say, amen. Well, let me lighten the mood a little bit by sharing with you some of my favorite quotes on forgiveness. I love great quotes. Some of you have learned that and you started sending them to me. Please keep it up. I always enjoy getting your quotes. Here's one that I really like. It's by one of my favorite authors, C.S. Lewis. So I think very wisely, but also very wittily said, everyone says that forgiveness is a lovely idea until he has something to forgive. It's really true, isn't it? Very, very true. I also like what the comedian Lily Tomlin, some of you may remember her from years ago, she once said, I heard her say, forgiveness is giving up all hope of a better past. I mean, yeah, some of you get it, and others are going, why is that funny? I would like a better past. Yeah, well, you can't have one, okay? Your past is your past. That's the whole point. From the standpoint of quotes that I think really are touching, I love a quote from, of all people, crusty old Mark Twain. Look what he said about forgiveness. He said, forgiveness is the fragrance of a violet that a violet sheds on the heel that has just crushed it. Isn't that a great quote? The fragrance that a violet gives to the heel that has just crushed it. Wow, that's a great quote. You know, it reminds me that today there are violets among us. People who have had things done to them that no one deserves. Things that happened to you in your life, maybe within your family, maybe it was an intruder from outside your family, maybe it was an extended family member, who knows? Who knows what the situation, whatever it was horrible, and you still bear the scar. And I just want you to know that it's, I don't want in any way minimize or trivialize your pain by us talking about this today. I want you to know that. I want you to know that this pain that you have suffered is real, and I am so deeply sorry. And God is deeply sorry as well. And no one would ever want to gloss over what happened to you. You know, I read something a while back that really stuck with me. It was by a counselor from a ministry called Focus on the Family, which is in the U.S. And by the way, if you'd like to do some research and your family needs additional insights and understandings, that's a great place to go. Focusonthefamily.org, O-R-G. Anyway, this was a family counselor from there who told a story that he got on a plane a while back, and it was a long flight, and it's so often the case, he wanted to get some sleep. But the lady who was sitting next to him wanted to talk. You know, sometimes that happens. And he decided that that her need was greater than his need, so he began to chat with her. And over time, it came out that he was a family counselor, and when she found that out, she began to open her life up to him. And come to find out what the situation was, that she had just been through a horrendously horrible, bitter divorce. And her husband had, you know, kind of a sordid, typical story where he had, you know, he had defrauded her, he had humiliated her, you know, he had cheated on her, and he eventually had abandoned her and, you know, her three young children, and through some conniving lawyers had pretty much left her destitute. You know, he'd hidden everything. He planned it well. And this kind of just all poured out of her. And I remember the guy writing, I thought this was so amazing. Matter of fact, I brought it, the exact quote. When she finished, I didn't know exactly what to say. But then I felt led to spontaneously but very sincerely say, listen, as a man, I'm sorry you had to suffer this injustice. No one deserves what he did to you. I despise what he did. He violated who you are. But he's not here, and I am. So I'm asking you to forgive me on his behalf. God loves you, and I love you. Tears flooded down her eyes, he writes. For a long time, she couldn't speak. Finally, she said, I didn't know I needed to hear that until this moment. I accept your apology, and I forgive you. We exchanged contact information, and I promised that my wife and I would pray for her. And a few months later, we got an email in which she said that apology freed her to begin a healing that she never thought was possible. Now, he goes on to say the point is not that we should run around trying to run up to people and ask for forgiveness for others. But the point is that we who have not had to experience, we who have been spared by the grace of God, some of the most painful hurts that can happen, have a responsibility to bear up the violets that have been crushed. So today, let me encourage you. Maybe you're saying, man, forgiveness isn't an issue for me. Well, you know what it is for a lot of people. And maybe what you hear today will help you to be like that guy, somebody who can help carry the load of others. Others of you may be saying, well, you know, I had trouble with forgiveness at one time, but I got over it. You know? I had something bad happen to me, or we had something bad happen to us as a family, but it's okay now, we forgave. Well, what I would suggest you do is to maybe consider what an expert would say. There is a wonderful book that is entitled Choosing Forgiveness by Nancy Lee DeMoss. And I want to show you what she says in here are some excellent questions that you should ask yourself to determine whether or not you've really processed this forgiveness. By the way, guys, this has stopped working, so you'll need to change it for me. So these questions are, let's go on. First question is, we're going to move through these quickly. I often replay in my mind the incident that hurt me. Do you do that? Number two, when I think of the particular person or place, I still get angry. Is that a problem? Anger a problem for you? Number three, I try hard not to think of the person, event, or circumstances that caused my pain. That's me. I'm a real forgiveness denier, you know. I say I've forgiven, but in reality, what I really mean is I've tried to erase that tape, and I don't want to think of those people anymore. Are you like that? How about the next one? I have a secret desire to see this person pay for what he or she did to me. Oh, yeah. Now we're getting in where I live. Yeah, now we are. How about this one? Deep in my heart, I hope to see something bad to that person, and I'm around to see it. I would just love it, you know, if some big guy beat the stuffings out of that guy. I often find myself telling others how this person hurt me. Do you do that? Do you find your mind drifting to this, and before you know it, it's coming up? Well, guess what happened to me? How about this one? A lot of my conversations revolve around this situation, and also, whenever his or her name comes up, I look for an opportunity to say something negative about that person who hurt me. Great book, by the way. You might want to pick that up. She goes on to say, my intention is not to load you down with guilt or insert additional blame into a situation that's already charged with hurt and emotion. But if we want to be free, we first have to acknowledge the depths that unforgiveness has reached in our lives. We have to recognize the damage it's caused and can cause. And we have to deal with the fact that our unforgiveness, listen now, our unforgiveness is a sin. No worse of a sin, but certainly no less of one. So today, let me ask you, what's so important about forgiveness? What's the big deal? Well, let me give you two simple answers to that question that I hope will help you to maybe deal with this problem in your own family. Number one, forgiveness is such a big deal, especially for those of us who consider ourselves followers of Christ, because as a follower of Christ, forgiveness for us is not optional. Did you know that? You know, it's not like we can say, well, you know, thank you, Lord. I love all the things you have to offer. The forgiveness thing, I'm going to pass it on to someone else, you know. I'm going to go right on hating and, you know, disliking these people because, you know, what they did to me was so horrible. Well, guess what? Jesus would say, you can't do that. No, you can't. Look what? Jesus expected that we would be forgiving people when he taught us how to pray. Remember that famous place where the disciples came and want to know about prayer? Remember, on the Sermon on the Mount, he just went ahead and kicked it in for us. And what does it say? You remember, you know, the Lord's Prayer, it's called? What did it say? And forgive us our what? Our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Listen, you can't pray the Lord's Prayer and not be a forgiving Christian. If you are, you're being hypocritical. Because Jesus assumed that that was going to be something that everyone who followed him would do. Not only that, but Jesus also said that there's no exceptions. Forgiveness is commanded, and it's not like the Lord said, okay, you know, you have to forgive them if they do that to you. If they do, oh yeah, that's included here. This is included. Yeah. Oh, this one, go ahead and hate them. That is such a terrible thing that I can't even forgive them of that. You can hate them with me. Right? No. Look what he says. I mean, this may shock you. This is right after he gave us the Lord's Prayer. With the trespasses thing, look what he says. This is Matthew 6. It says, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses.
Wow.
Now that is something. You mean there's no exceptions? No exceptions. Whenever I read this verse, I think of all things of an old comedian that I love. I don't know if you ever heard of him or not, but his name was W.C. Fields. You might hear of him. He was like in the early part of the movies, in the early part of the 20th century. And I don't know, he was just a counter comedian kind of guy. He was ornery and, you know, just constantly looking for the easiest way out and, you know, just real hilarious for me. Anyway, he was like always drinking on and off the screen and, you know, a real womanizer, had a terrible reputation. And he had a real funny delivery. He's an old vaudeville comedian. He talked out of the side of his mouth like this. Like, yes, how are you? Anyway, one day he was on the movie set and between takes, and he was sitting in his, you know, big chair with his name on the back, and some actors walked by, and they saw him. And he was furiously looking through a book, and they noticed it was a Bible, of all things. And they said, Bill, you know, William W.C. Fields' name was William. Bill, what are you doing with a Bible? You know what he said? Classic response. He said, I'm looking for loopholes. That's right. And I had that written down for you, but it's not going to come up. Oh, boy. So click it for me, would you? Thank you. Good job. Anyways, looking for loopholes. Guess what? There are no loopholes. Do you know that? There are no loopholes. Doesn't exist. Let's go back. Are no loopholes? The loopholes don't exist. No such thing. Especially when it comes to this area of forgiveness. What you've got to decide is, if I'm a follower of Christ, then I need to do this. Now, let me quickly tell you that this can lead to some confusion. Matter of fact, just last week, I had a woman come up to me, and she didn't even know that we were talking about it, and she wanted to ask me about this because she was very concerned. I think it was her father who had passed away recently, and he was a Christian, but he also was a person who really struggled with something that had happened. He had a lot of anger and hatred in his life, and her concern was that it was because of this verse that he wouldn't go to heaven. And what I told her is what I believe, which is that here Jesus is not trying to give us a new unforgivable sin. He's not trying to say, you know, this is it and this is it alone. This is the only question that's going to be on the final, you know, when you get to heaven. I don't think he meant that. The only unforgivable sin, according to what Jesus said, is to blaspheme the Holy Spirit by, you know, rejecting his work in our lives and not receiving Christ, essentially. So I think that what Jesus is saying is that, yeah, there are probably Christians who struggle with forgiveness. I know I do at times. There have been some very difficult things that have happened in Alana's and mine 40 years together as a couple, raising our 4 children. Some things happened to our children that I can't even think of without struggling again with it. So, you know, we've dealt with it. We've forgiven. We've forgiven each other of things. I mean, forgiveness in every family. And sometimes it's difficult. I realize that. And I think God, who loves us, realizes that. But I think what he is saying is that if you believe that you're a follower of Christ, you cannot have this private area of hatred, this area of unforgiveness that you harbor, however horrible the offense, and I agree with you, it's horrible, but you cannot disconnect your forgiveness from your faith. You can't do that. If you're a follower of Christ, you have to be willing to deal with this process of forgiveness. And the Lord expects that. And the Lord will ask us about that when he sees us. Yeah. Another thing is, I think Jesus clearly taught us about forgiveness repeatedly in the parables. Did you know that? You know how many parables Jesus taught us, these wonderful stories that Jesus taught? You know how many there are? Depending on, you know, which Bible scholar you believe, about 50. There's some debate about whether certain parables are so short they may just be wise sayings. But around 50 parables. Do you know how many of those parables deal with forgiveness? And again, it kind of depends on me. But from my reading, about 1 in 4 parables deal with forgiveness. That's 25% of all the stories Jesus told directly related to somebody forgiving somebody about something. Amazing. And one of the classic places he taught about it was over in Matthew chapter 18. And it all resulted from a question that you or I could very easily have asked Jesus had we been there. Look at this. Then Peter, of course it's always Peter, then Peter came up and said to him, Lord, how often will my brother sin against me and I forgive him? As many as seven times? You need to realize that at the day, there were two principal schools, rabbinical schools, and one school said that you had to forgive three times, and another school you had to give seven times. So Peter took the more conservative view. So he was really, he said, listen, I'll forgive somebody seven times if they do something. And what did Jesus say? Jesus said, I say to you, not seven times, but what? 77 times. Or some say 70 times 7, 490 times. So, meaning what? That you need to count that many? You got a clicker? Oh, okay, 489, 400, all right, I'm going to let them have it. No, that's not it. The point is what? It's an endless number of times. And then he tells a story to illustrate his point. Once upon a time, there was a kingdom, the kingdom of heaven may be compared to this. Once upon a time, there was a king who wished to settle accounts with his servants. And when he began to settle, one was brought to him who owed him 10,000 talents. Now stop a minute. This is an enormous amount of money. A talent, as a measure of money in Jesus' day, was 1,000 silver coins. So that would be the equivalent today of about 10 million U.S. dollars. Think about that. This guy owed his employer $10 million. And it's an incredible amount. And since he could not pay, his master had ordered him to be sold, along with his wife and children, all that he had, into slavery, in other words, in order that he could, get what little he could out of them for the debt. And the man, what did he do? So the servant fell on his knees, imploring him, have patience with me, and I will repay you everything. Now, is that possible? Could this guy pay back $10 million in a... Yeah, maybe in 50 lifetimes, or 100 lifetimes. But no, there was no way. And out of pity for him, the master of that servant released him and forgave him the debt. And when that same servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii. 100 denarii would be the equivalent of 18 cents in today's money. So this fellow slave owed him about $18. U.S. dollars. 10 million, 18. And seizing the man, he began to choke him, saying, pay me what you owe. So his fellow servant fell down, pleaded with him, have patience with me, and I will repay you. He could do that. It may take a while, but he could do that. But he refused, and he went and put him in prison until he should pay the debt, which means his family was going to be destitute. And when his fellow servants saw what had taken place, they were greatly distressed, and they went and reported to their master all that had taken place. Then his master, the king, summoned him and said, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me. And should you not have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all his debt. Read this with me. So also my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. Those are the very words from the lips of Jesus. Forgive from your heart. What's the point? The point is that our sin, our many, many sins, not just our outward sins, but our inward sinfulness, our brokenness inside, all the evil and the filth and the anger and the lust and, the times we've killed people in our minds and all of those things, that is such an enormous amount that God has forgiven us of. How can we not forgive a fellow human being, even though it might be a terrible thing they did to you? But compared to what we've done to God, there's no comparison. No comparison. Wow. That's amazing. A second reason I think forgiveness is such a big thing is because of what it does to us as families, as individuals, if we don't forgive. And there's a number of things we could give here, but for the sake of time, let me just share two. One of the things that not forgiving will do to you and your family is that will allow bitterness to take root, which can ultimately destroy your family. That's what the Bible says. Bitterness can take root in you and your life, the life of your family members, totally destroy you. Where does it say it? It says it in Hebrews chapter 12. By the way, before I read this to you, are you familiar with Hebrews? It's an amazing book. A lot of people skip over it. I think it's probably the least read book of the New Testament. It's a fascinating book, the purpose of which is to essentially show how great Jesus is compared to the old way of relating to God through the Old Testament, through the Levitical system. In other words, the superiority of the New Covenant over the Old Covenant. And we think it was written probably not long before the destruction of Jerusalem in the late 60s. We're not sure exactly who wrote it. It's actually the only book in the New Testament that we don't have a pretty good idea. It may have been written by Paul. It may have been written by Barnabas, some people think. It may have been written by a guy named Silvanus. It may have been written by a husband and wife team, Priscilla and Aquila from Corinth. But anyway, whoever wrote it knew a whole lot about the Old Testament and being Jewish, and they knew a whole lot about Jesus and following him. And in this one particular place, because I want you to get the big picture here, in chapter 12, the author of Hebrews is essentially encouraging us about endurance, that we mustn't give up, that we need to hang in there with following Christ. And he has this beautiful statement at the beginning of chapter 12. He says, we need to recognize that there's this a large cloud of witnesses surrounding us and who are watching us. And we need to, avoid every entanglement that can keep us from running the race of following Christ. We need to keep our eyes upon Jesus. And some people think that means that there's all these people who've gone on to heaven who are looking down on us, and maybe that's true, I don't know. But I think this verse really means, because that word witness is where we get our English word martyrs. And so I think it's talking about all the people who have gone before the writer at that time of Hebrews. And he's saying all the people back in the Old Testament, all these faithful followers of God who suffered for their belief in Yahweh God, who looked forward to the coming of the Messiah, these people's legacy is a testimony to us. I mean, we've got this grandstand full of people who have endured, and we need to endure too. And as he goes on through the chapter, it's a remarkable chapter, you should read it, he talks about enduring, he or she talks about enduring in relationships. It's amazing. He says, don't give up in your relationships as Christians. Here's what he says. Pursue peace with all men and the holiness without which no one can see God. Are you a Christian? Then you need to be working at being peaceful. Not adversarial, not angry, not vengeful. Be at peace. I know there's some wicked people out there. You need to try and be at peace with them. The reason? Because that's true holiness before God. I mean, this is what God wants us to be like. Only through Christ can we be this way. But you need to practice who you are. A different person than you used to be. And then verse 15, see to it that no one comes short of the grace of God. Isn't that a great way of saying it? See, don't come short of the grace that's been shown you. One of the ways you become short is how? By not being someone who's at peace with all people. Be careful that you don't allow a root of bitterness, there it is right there, to spring up and cause trouble, because by that many have been defiled, have been made unholy, not the way God wants them to be. Remarkable word that's used here. This word bitterness, pikria, comes from the word pick, which is exactly what, that's one of those words that's, is what it sounds like. It's a sharp pointed instrument. It also can be a sharp, pungent smell. Pikria is used of like any foul smelling liquid, but specifically it's used for the poison. It's a Greek word for poison. Isn't that amazing? I mean, I think it's so remarkable. Literally, what the author of Hebrews is saying, God through this author is saying to us is, pursue peace. Don't be one of those people that holds a grudge. Don't be one of those people who refuses to forgive. Because when you do, it's just like you're injecting poison into your veins and into the veins of your family. But don't do that. Bitterness, it's pictured like a root that produces a tree, a fruit that's bitter and poisonous. And that's what you're doing when you raise a family. You're raising fruit that's going to be bitter and poisonous. You want to destroy your son or daughter's relationship in the future, like who they're going to marry, their marriage? Great, then teach them not to forgive. And you will absolutely sabotage your future son-in-law or daughter-in-law. And your grandkids, boy, good luck. It's terrible. That's what the author's saying. One of my favorite authors right now, I guess probably my very favorite author, is a guy named John Ortberg. And he writes in one of his books this phrase that has stuck with me. He basically says, bitterness is like drinking rat poison and waiting for the rat to die. Now, there's a lot of rats out there. You could use the poison. But when I drink it, I'm just being a fool. Absolute fool. Another thing that's fascinating, see how the verse doesn't end there at verse 15. It actually goes on to verse 16. And look what God does. He adds an illustration. And if you know anything about the Old Testament, you'll be amazed by it, the illustration he uses. He says, don't have the root of bitterness spring up, which may cause trouble, which does cause trouble, and may become, and you may, many are defiled, that there be no immoral or godless person like Esau, who sold his own birthright for a single meal. He's using Esau as an illustration of somebody who had a root of bitterness. You know the story of Esau? A fascinating story. It goes way, way back in the Old Testament, way, way before Jesus. And there was a guy named Isaac, and he had two sons, Jacob and Esau. And Jacob was his very name means deceiver. And he was somebody who was constantly conniving. And one of the things he wanted, he was actually the second born of these twins. Esau came out first and then Jacob. And Jacob despised that because that meant Esau was the firstborn. He got the biggest part of the spoils of the blessing. And so what did Jacob do was he tricked his aged father into giving him the blessing that really should have gone to his brother. And he actually, one day when his brother came in, he was starving, and Jacob was a man of the house. He knew how to cook and everything. He fixed this beautiful porridge stew thing, and he essentially said to Esau, I'll give you some if you give me your birthright. And Esau just, being very flippant, just gave it away. And later, when Esau realized what had happened, he became enraged. And even look what it says. This is all in Genesis 37. And Esau cried out with an exceedingly great and bitter cry. It says that right in the text. And Esau bore a grudge against his brother Jacob and proclaimed, I will kill my brother. So Esau is a classic example of someone who was bitter and who, as a result, the bitterness affected him badly. And boy, you have to turn and read in Genesis 37 if you want to see what happened to Esau. Incredible. Sad story. Matter of fact, eventually, I'll just give you a little insight. Jacob, the mother of these two boys, came and told Jacob, you need to get out of here. Your brother is crazy. He's going to kill you. And so Jacob fled and went far away to another country. Stayed there gone for a long, long time. And finally, it was important to the promises of God that he come back, because God had already prophesied that it was through Jacob, the Messiah, Jesus was going to come hundreds and hundreds of years later. So Jacob finally, got to his senses and after many, many years came back to meet his brother Esau. And there's this poignant scene where Jacob sees Esau far off and he's wondering, is Esau still hatred? Does he hate me? Is he going to come and kill me? What's going to happen? And you know what happens? Well, you turn to Genesis 37 and you'll find out. It's a great story. You should read it. Make a good movie. I'm telling you. But anyway, the point is what? Don't be like that guy. Don't be like Esau. Don't allow that to happen to your family. Don't do that. The other thing that's important that forgiveness occur is this. Without forgiveness, guess what? Love cannot grow. Love cannot grow. It's stunted. It's different than it is with forgiveness. And as a result, relationships which should be loving between parents and children, between siblings, between husbands and wives, it's amazing how love can turn to what? Hatred. Oh, man. Absolutely. I mean, some of you newlyweds who may be here, and you're just saying, you're just thinking, oh, we love each other so much. It's so good. I mean, you would be surprised at people that I've seen like that who just within a couple, 3 years, can be vehement enemies against each other and literally can wish the worst on each other. I mean, I've seen couples, I didn't think I was going to be able to keep them in the same room, trying to do marital counseling. They hated each other so much. I mean, again, the Word of God tells us this. Look at Proverbs 17:9. Amazing bit of wisdom from God. Love prospers when, what? A fault is forgiven, but dwelling on it separates even the closest of friends. So another translation, it says, love forgets mistakes and grows. Refusing to forgive separates friends and families alike. Whew, man, that is right where we live. There's another, I didn't put this, you might want to jot this down, I didn't put it on your outline, but Proverbs 10:12 says, hatred stirs up strife, but love covers all transgressions. Isn't that true? Listen, this is good stuff whether you're a Christian or not. It's still true. It's still true. So do you need forgiveness? Absolutely. Absolutely. How do you have forgiveness? Well, let me close by just quickly saying, giving you four suggestions. This is one of those things, that we could take 6 weeks just to talk about this. But let me recommend a couple of good books. One I've already mentioned, which is Choosing Forgiveness by Nancy Lee DeMoss. The other is a non-Christian book, although I think the lady is a Christian, but this is written more from a non-Christian or secular perspective. It's called The Forgiveness Formula, How to Let Go of Pain and Move On with Your Life by Kathleen Griffin, who I think is a BBC broadcaster. But she tells about a very tragic story of how she was abducted when she was 11 years of age and really kind of tells what happened. And she was able to get away and survive, but she didn't tell anyone because she was so ashamed. And that often happens. And finally, it was years later before she finally had to deal with this. And then she had to deal with forgiving this man who did this to her. She had to forgive her parents who didn't, she felt protect her. She had to forgive herself, her 11-year-old self. And sometimes that can be the toughest person of all to forgive, can't it? Yeah. Anyway, good tools. I'd recommend them to you. But let me give you quickly four things that I hope will be of help. There's a little place on your program you got when you came in. You might want to jot these down. They might be of help to you sometime. Number one, we can forgive, guess why? Because we've been forgiven. Yeah, the New Testament says it clearly. Paul writes it so beautifully. He says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger, that word bitterness, that's pikria, what we were just talking about. Bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you, along with all malice, along with all hatred. And then read this last part with me. Be kind to one another, tenderhearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. Man, that is so powerful. You have to realize, listen, beloved. You have to realize that it's that king with the two slaves. And the slave owes the $10 million. That's us. That's me. That's you. And we did it. We're guilty. And we deserve to be punished. And instead, what does the king do? He says, you know, this $10 million, something's got to happen about this. I'll tell you what's going to happen. I'm going to call my one and only son, my beloved son. Hey, come here. Now, put him here in front of us and torture him to death. Hang him on a cross until he bleeds out and his heart breaks and he suffers the greatest insult that anyone could ever suffer. Let him do that, and then I'll forgive you of your $10 million. Go on and do that to him. And that son dies while you watch. And the king says, okay, your debt's paid. You can go on. That's what happened. He died for us. Because we've been forgiven, we can what? We can sure go forgive other. And again, I don't mean to minimize what happened to you. Listen, forgiveness is not reconciliation. I'm not saying you just, you know, because somebody did this horrible thing to you, you just casually say, oh, okay, well, never mind, it's fine. You know, wink, wink, it's okay. Just go right ahead. No big deal. No, not at all. Nor is forgiveness trust. It takes a long time to give trust. And I'm not saying you just need to, yeah, go right ahead, yeah. Oh, you're sorry you had the affair. Oh, good, fine, come on home, no problem. You know, we'll just start over. No, it takes time. But I am saying that in your heart, God is wanting us to understand that because we've been forgiven, so we have to forgive. We have to do that. Another thing that can help us is we need to realize that forgiveness can happen because it's not a feeling, but it's an action. I think too often we identify forgiveness with emotion, and we think we have to feel somehow cheerful and happy and free. Listen, forgiveness is a process. It can be a very, very long process, depending on the severity of the pain that's in your family. But the thing that we can know by what Jesus told us and what he expects of us is that it's a commitment of the will. It's a decision. It's taking a step. I mean, I remember a famous story from Corrie Ten Boom. I don't know if you've heard of her or not. Remarkable woman. She and her, was a Dutch lady, and she and her family were Christians, and they felt burdened about what was happening to the Jews during World War II. And so they actually had a Jewish family living, you know, in the crawl space of their home, protecting them from the Holocaust. And finally, one day, someone told on them. And sure enough, the Nazis came and arrested she and her whole family. And Corrie Ten Boom, who eventually survived a concentration camp, three concentration camps, wrote a book about this. And it was amazing. And she talks about how in the concentration camp, of course, she never saw her father again, never saw her brother again. She and her sister were able to be together. Their mother died early on. Eventually, her precious sister that she loved all her life died. Corrie was the only one to survive. And years later, she was telling her story, and she wrote a book about it, and she became rather well-known. And she was traveling over, you know, Europe, which was being rebuilt at the time, telling people the story of forgiveness. And suddenly she was talking to people after one of the meetings, and who should walk up but a man who'd been a guard at one of the concentration camps she'd been in. Now, how would you react? And I remember Corrie Ten Boom, she wrote in the book, I'll never forget it. It's called The Hiding Place. She wrote in there that I couldn't look at him. I lowered my eyes. I couldn't look at the man's face. I didn't know what I was going to do. And then this verse came to my mind. If the Lord is going to forgive me, then I must be willing to forgive others. And I told the Lord, I cannot forgive this man. I cannot do that. You're going to have to forgive him through me. And so she said, what I did was I said, Lord, I can raise my hand. That's all I can do. And so I raised my hand, and he grasped my hand, and I looked up, and he said, Fine, you may not know this, but I was a guard at a concentration camp. I have since become a Christian, and I'm grief-stricken over what I did to people. And I just wanted to come and ask your forgiveness. And she said it was then that the Lord began to change her heart. And she was able to say words she never thought she'd say. She said, I forgive you. Forgiveness is an action. We know that because of what Jesus said in Luke 6. Look at these things. He tells us to love, to be merciful, to judge, to give. All of these are actions. You may not feel things, but I mean, it's like when you tell your wife you love her, your wife may not always feel like she loves you, but she's going to take action to love you. That's what commitment is. You know, giving is the same way. I may not feel generous today, but I know you need this more than I do. I'm going to give it to you. And forgiveness is like that. It's an action that we have to commit to do, and then God will bless us through it. Third thing is very important, too, to remember this. Forgiveness can come because there's really only one person who deserves not to be forgiven, and who's that? Satan. The only one is Satan. And there's a great verse in Revelation chapter 12 where John, of course, is seeing this great vision of what's to come in the future, in the last days. And it says in Revelation 12, 9, and the great dragon was thrown out, the serpent of old, who is called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. You see that? Who deceives the whole world. And he was thrown down along with his angels, talking about the judgment that's coming. One of the things we need to realize is that Satan is the culprit. He is the one. No telling what the person who did whatever it was they did to you, or the family member who did whatever they do, no telling what happened in their past. You may not even know what happened to them. Maybe somebody did the same thing to them. Maybe it's gone on for generations. You know, it's a generational thing. And you need to realize that sometimes people can be as much victim as they can be perpetrator. And I know, again, that doesn't mean that person is not responsible. Not individually responsible, and God will deal with them. And you can be assured of that. And of course, one of the worst things we can do is try to have vengeance. What does the Bible say in Hebrews? Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. Back away and let God have them. God can do a whole lot more to you than you can. He'll deal with them. You just forgive. And you blame Satan, because he's the one who really deserves the blame. Finally, last thing. We can forgive because it's what? Yeah, it's God's Spirit. It gives us the strength. I love this verse. I think it's overused, but in this case, I think it's very appropriate. And it's what? Say it with me. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. That's really true. I want to conclude by showing you a video. And it's a video, another one about a song, but it's a song that I have loved for a long time, but I had no idea until I saw this video, the story behind the song. And I want to encourage you to do two things. Number one, I want to encourage you to concentrate over these next few minutes. Because I believe that there is probably, I know there is, being a pastor this many years, there are people sitting right there in your seats who need forgiveness, who need to deal with forgiveness, who need to ask forgiveness, who need to receive forgiveness. They need to forgive others. And we need to allow them the quiet they need. And secondly, I would encourage you the fact that if you're resisting what God's trying to do in your life in this area, don't do that. Don't do it. Stop. Let the walls come down and watch this video, would you? Let's watch.
Over the past few years, I've been on this journey of writing songs inspired by the real-life stories that people sent to me. This one story in particular has had a profound impact on me. It hit me kind of hard. It's about a woman who did the impossible, and it made me ask myself, if I could do the same. Renee had four kids. Two of her daughters were twins. Megan was coming home from the beach one night with her best friend when their car was struck by a drunk driver named Eric, a 24-year-old kid. Megan lost her life. Eric killed both girls that were in the car. Renee lost her daughter in an instant. Next thing she knows, she finds herself in a courtroom watching this young man, this 24-year-old man, get sentenced to 22 years in prison. Renee wrote to me and said, "I now have a mission that I never would have chosen." What she meant by that is that in the years that follow, she began to travel around to schools and churches and different functions, and she would speak about the dangers of drunk driving. But as the years progressed, she felt like something was missing from her presentations. And that's when God put it on her heart that she had not forgiven this man who took the life of her daughter. And so she reached out and did the impossible. She reached out to Eric in prison and said, "I forgive you." The ripple effects of that act of forgiveness are still being felt today. That young man's life was absolutely changed because this woman forgave him. He said, "I can't even forgive myself," and she forgave me. Eric said he found his eternal salvation as a result of this act. One by one, all of Renee's family members followed her lead, and they reached out and expressed forgiveness to Eric. So much so that now they describe Eric as part of their family, like a son to Renee. The story doesn't stop there, though. Renee went to the courts along with her family, and she was able to have Eric's sentence cut in half from 22 years to 11 years. This blew me away. And the reason she did it is so that Eric could have a second chance at life and so that he could join her in their presentations. She told me that now she shares not only about the dangers of drunk driving, but also about the power of forgiveness.
He told me that day, the day of the hearing, that it didn't matter at this point. He said, "You know, if the judge does not grant this for me, I want you to know that I am so grateful that you are willing to do this." And he said, "And I will be okay." He said, I'll be fine. But he was blown away by the fact that we were willing to go before the judge and you know, plead for him to not have to be there for 22 years.
Thing to give away, the last thing on your mind today, and it always goes to those who don't deserve it. It's the opposite of how you feel when the pain they cause is just too real. It takes everything you have to say the word forgiveness.
I was more than angry at Eric. I had so much rage inside of me, and yet the moment that I was able to look Eric in his eyes and tell him that I forgive him, you know, that was a moment that healing began for both of us.
It's always anger's own worst enemy. And even when the jury and the judge say you got a right to hold a grudge, it's the whisper in your ear saying, "Set it free. Forgiveness."
A judge and a jury telling you that it's okay to hold a grudge, you know, that's what the world says. It's okay for you to feel that way, which it is. But yet, those feelings, they're inside of you, eating away at you, and you don't want to live your life that way.
Forgiveness. Show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable.
There are people who are not going to ever have someone say to them, "I'm sorry for what I did," or "I take responsibility for what I did," and you still have to forgive if you want to heal.
It can even set a prisoner free. There is no end to what its power can do. So let it go and be amazed by what you see through eyes of grace. The prisoner that it really frees is you.
forgiveness.
You're not letting go of what happened. You know, it is wrong. It should never have happened. It is not okay. It doesn't mean that you're canceling any of that out. But once you are able to say those words and truly mean it, you know, then you do find that you're setting a prisoner free, and the prisoner truly is you.
Show me how to love the unlovable. Show me how to reach the unreachable. Help me now to do the impossible. Yeah. Forgiveness, I want to finally set it free. Show me how to see what your mercy sees. Help me now to give what you gave to me.
I was immediately inspired by Renee's story when I read it, but it took me a while to write her song. I kept her story in my guitar case for about 2 years, and I realized the reason why it was so difficult to write this song, Forgiveness, is because it's kind of hard to live that out. That's why the words of the chorus are sung in the form of a prayer. God, show me how. Help me to do the impossible. This story of forgiveness really makes me think that there's some pretty life-defining questions that all revolve around that one word, forgiveness. Questions like, is there somebody that I need to forgive, that I've been holding on to a grudge and it's weighing me down? Every step's getting heavier and I just need to set it free. Another question is there someone that I need to go and ask for forgiveness from? To say, I'm humbling myself, I'm sorry, no excuses, can we start over? Another forgiveness question, one that Eric has had to deal with in prison, is, can I ever forgive myself? What if loving the unlovable means having to learn how to love that person you see when you look in the mirror? Sometimes that's not an easy task, which really leads to the most significant forgiveness question of all. And it's this, have I ever let it really sink in? The message of God's forgiveness, what he's done for me through his son Jesus dying on a cross for my sins. Renee stood before that judge, along with all of her family members, taking turns speaking on behalf of a guilty criminal and seeking mercy for him. I'm reminded that somebody has done that for me, somebody has done that for you. His name is Jesus. For God demonstrates his own love for us in this: while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Why did he do that? So that our stories could discover the healing, the victory, the redemption, the power, the freedom of one word, forgiveness.
Would you bow your heads with me? Yeah. You know, I want to encourage you that if God has talked to you today about something in your life regarding forgiveness, it may well be that you need to see somebody, maybe pray with somebody, ask some questions, maybe look at some scripture together. If you want to leave right now and slip up, you go ahead and slip out. You can. You go out the door, turn left, come to the hallway, turn right. There's a prayer room there. There's people there right now who are waiting to talk to you if you'd like to do that. For others of you, maybe you'd like to pray right now, right here. And there's a prayer that I've prepared that I want to pray. And you can pray in your heart something similar to this. Dear God, I understand that I must forgive, and then you fill in the name of that family member, whoever that is. You know who it is. Maybe it's a long time ago, but you know who it is. Maybe it's something that happened just recently. Today, I understand that I must forgive whoever it is, however many there are, of the hurt and pain that they caused me. I need to forgive them, not because they have sought my forgiveness, because if I don't, my family and I will never be free. I also understand that forgiving them is what you want me to do, Lord. I don't know if I can do it. As a matter of fact, I'm pretty sure I can't. So today I surrender my heart and my life to you.
I place my faith in Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of my sins. Because you've forgiven me, I can forgive them. Fill me with your love and forgiveness and help me to see them as you do. And Lord, help me to make this decision every day for the rest of my life. I'm not sure where you are on the journey of forgiveness, but I just want to encourage you. Take whatever step the next step is for you. Heavenly Father, thank you that you don't leave us as orphans, but that you fill us with your Holy Spirit, who can care for us and protect us and watch over us and seal us and guard us and guide us and instruct us and Lord, can even empower us to do things like forgiving that which is unforgivable. And I pray today that this would be a time of real, of the chains of unforgiveness coming off in a lot of lives, including mine. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray.